had power, and then now we're going to talk railroads, because they were really hand in hand. And of course, the railroad had come into Bryant Pond in 1850, and that was the connection, unless you went to Canton, where the railroad came in, what they call Gilbertville. That was in the, well, we've talked about the possibility of the Bryant Pond one and so forth, but the railroads got in here, and here is a, in 1892, you can see the first,
So, all those.
That looks, looking across toward Mexico.
Chisholm, though, financed the railroad up through?
The early, before it changed into Main Central Railroad, that's right. Rumford Falls Portland Railroad Company connected up. They bought the Buckfield branch. And that, there's the roundhouse section where they turned the trains around. Here's the first railroad station over on where Agway is now. And it was a, that was the building. They brought in, the McGregors were the primary contractors here, and they brought, this was when the Italians got in here. And here's a scene, the living conditions were horrible at that time. There's a scene, they tell about the mud and slab houses, and there was a scene where a typical housing for the Italians, they're building it. That they dubbed that picture Roman Villa. It's written on the back. And one of the men that was prominent in the building of the railroad was a man by the name of Cleon Osgood, who was in Hartford or Sumner. And he was the railroad master. They called him the roadmaster for the railroad. And he later became part of the town of Rumford operation. Pettingill apparently urged him they were having terrible water problems, drinking water problems. And they brought him and set up the Rumford Water District. He wrote the charter and got it passed through the legislature, and was the first engineer for the water district. In those early days of the trains to the, they used to take excursions down to Canton Point, to the beach at Canton. It was later, a few years later, in fact, in 1894, the railroad was started to be built up in the Rangeley region. That was called the Rangeley Lakes, Rumford Falls Rangeley Lakes Region Railroad. Right. And that was completed in 1895. So they did things fast in those days. And now the paper companies. Paper making followed. And we have a lot of pictures here of the early, of that early period. To be exact, we've got to refer to notes here. This picture here is shown in the album, the early album of Rumford, was the earliest phase of papermaking. The picture was taken in June of 93. And if you'll notice a little bit to the left of the skank house, of the smokestack, you see the skank house on the hill. Now, Garrett Skank came here in 1892, and he supervised the building and became the manager of the Rumford Falls Paper Company. The Rumford Falls Paper Company made the first paper in here. He would, Skank came here, he'd been in Madison, had a part in the making of the Indian Springs Paper Company, which became part of the Great Northern. Easton Fibers, is it in Brewer? And there was the Penobscot Fibers in, I think it was Old Town. He'd been involved in those, and he was only something like 38, 40 years old when he got here. He'd been brought up, in the rag making, in the rag paper making business by his father. That's how he apparently got into it. Well, he purchased 3 acres up at the junction of, you can see by the location of the picture here, and we have other snapshots too. And he organized it, he brought in people, he brought in a man by the name of John Decker, who became the mill manager, a mill superintendent. And they started making paper. A few years later, the Mullen brothers of Bangor came over. They were interested in developing the Great Northern Paper Company, and they got him to go up there. But in the meantime, the Continental Paper Bag Mill had sprung up, and the Rumford Falls Paper Company had been sold to the International Paper Company, and both Skank and Chisholm were stock owners and big stock owners, proprietors, really. So they, for some reason, Skank decided to leave, break up the partnership that he'd had with Chisholm. For what reason, we don't know, but apparently, it would seem that the Great Northern proposition was more attractive. Interestingly enough, he knew that he had to acquire an immense amount of land up there, and he'd made a friendship with George Stearns, who had come here and had been the postmaster in Rumford and had been the first principal of the high school, and he took him to Millinocket with him. And he became the land agent for the Great Northern Paper Company.
As Pitt and Gill had
chosen. That's right. That's very true. Yeah. And so that's the story of that. Now, so the Continental Paper Bag Mill started springing up. And here in the Board of Trade Journal in 1906, you'll see a picture of the inside of the mill. But here is a photograph here. Now that was started up in 1899, the name of Herman Elsus. And it by 1906, there were 700 people working in that mill. It waded through hard times. Some of the boarding houses over in the Falmouth Street, Cumberland Street area were built by Elsus for his employees that he had to bring them in here, the same as Chisholm had built Strathgask Park for his employees. It's amazing that the amount of work that was done there. They claim they made as high as 20 million paper bags in a day in that mill. And they shipped out by train loads. During hard times, the mill ran into a lot of trouble. And especially during the Depression. And they had gone to the town, as Chisholm had before, asking for a break in taxes. Right. And that they had a sort of a hilarious town meeting in 1929. They claimed over 1,200 people in the building at a town meeting where to be decided whether they would give them tax abatement. The strange part of it is less than 200 people voted because they didn't want to be seen voted for or against this, but the vote went against them. They were told, the townspeople were told at that time, that it probably would be in the losing of the mill, because they, popular Rumford man was quoted in the newspapers getting up and saying if it's sympathy they want, let's send them flowers.
Okay.
And that was the tone of the meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Well, hard times came, and in 1936 they packed up and they left, and 700 people lost their jobs. Now, the Oxford paper, the original, was organized in 1899, and the contract to build started in 1900. Now, here's a kind of interesting photo. At the time, Pittengill was started buying up land. This was Walton property in the foreground. This is where the mill is today. You can see Mexico in the background. You can see Mexico, the Abbott School in Mexico there on the side hill. That property was in the town of Peru.
Oh, yes, right.
And later became part of Rumford. When the Peru people in 1895 saw the ethnic, the Italians springing up in what is now Smith's Crossing, and the shacks, they envisioned tremendous pauper costs and so forth, and they said down there, let's get rid of it. And they did get rid of it. It became part of Rumford, and because the original line ran nearly, I would say, from the maps, about the top of the ridge in back of east of the power company. Probably the Rumford Falls Power Company, the first mill there would have been in Rumford, but certainly where the mill is today, as we know it, would have been in part of Peru. The Chisholm era was an interesting and a prosperous area for Rumford, really. The buildings that he built, had built, and responsible for building. Here you see the magnificent, it's known as the E.K. Day Building. Now it's the Harris, later the Harris Hotel Building, but notice the ornamentation. The E.K. Day Company had come here early on across the street, and apparently this building was built specially for the E.K. Day Company, because they were the sole occupants, although there were offices in there, but it became known as that. And when it partially destroyed by fire, it ended and became, well, it had become a hotel. No, it had, the hotel formed after the fire, Harris Hotel.
Right.
And, but the magnificence of the building, and here is an early photo of the power company building. And of course, he was responsible for the Mechanics Institute. Hugh Chisholm did many things for the town. And at one time, the citizens of the town felt that something should be done to honor him. And so too promising citizens of that time, Ralph Clark and Dennis Houdin, decided it was time to honor the second Hugh Chisholm. In 1956, and got a group of people together, and this was to be a citizens group, not a mill, not not the people that he employed, the people that he was associated with. And on the 27th day of September 1956, Hugh Chisholm Day became a reality. If you remember your television programs, that was the area of the Ralph Edwards productions, and This Is Your Life. And this the program that day was based on This Is Your Life. It was held in the Armory. About 500 people attended. It was catered by a catering establishment from Lewiston. The band, the high school band, was there, and it was really a pleasant time, because he met old acquaintances. One of the people participated was Bess Green, who was the daughter of Walter Pettengill, and of course they were socially, it was that generation that they were associated with. One of the participants was a man by the name of Clayton Sweat from Andover, who was a guide, an old guide, and he'd guided Chisholm. He'd guided both Hugh Chisholms, in fact, over the years. And it really was a success. And Chisholm himself was really touched by the program. The other events of the time, of course, were the centennials, the sesquicentennials, the ski carnivals, and various other enterprises, many of which took in the municipal building auditorium. We have to take note at this time of the centennial and the sesquicentennials. Now, they did it really up Brown, Rumford's centennial. It took place at Rumford Center in 1900. It planned on for it for more than a year. The town, actually, the town appropriated money to help out. People came from, they say, according to the times, people came from miles and miles around by horse and buggy, of course, and for weeks they were streaming into Rumford by train. People, every house was full, and that day came they couldn't find places really to hitch horses there, even though it rained, poured every day, but people came just the same, and they say that the 2,500 people signed the register for that day. So that was a big affair. Now, strangely enough, Rumford Sesquicentennial passed by unnoticed, the 150th. No one thought about it, I guess. But the Rumford Historical Society didn't let it pass for the 175th. Right. And that was a three-day affair staged at Rumford Center. It was the first night, the first town meeting was portrayed by descendants, direct descendants of those who participated in the very first town meeting in 1800. And the second day was the exhibitions in the Grange Hall, the exhibits and so forth, and the demonstrations of the old craft trades in the what they call the meeting house. And of course, on the third day, there was the old time religious service in the meeting house, conducted by Reverend Kingsbury and Reverend Niles. Now, Mexico celebrated its 150th in style with souvenir programs. They had a week-long program, and this is the material that came out from there. Of course, their sesquicentennial was due to come. No, the 175th due to come. I get mixed up here sometimes. You have to excuse me. Now, Peru held its centennial in 1921 in the Rockamica Grange Hall. And they recognized it, and they had a very prosperous and very entertaining program for this celebration. Andover celebrated their 150th, as most towns do. Now, of course, there were other events around, and many of them were held in what was called the wigwam. Now, everybody knows through history, the wigwam was a canal street, and it was the first town building. All the fairs were held there. Here is a picture of the Universalist Fair being held there. Town meetings were held there, and when the town meetings were got too large for the wigwam, they went to the Cheney Opera House. Building in Rumford went terrifically fast. A man by the name of Willard White from Dixfield was the real building supervisor here. History doesn't tell us how many men he had working for him, but there are accounts in newspapers where they slept in tents on sawdust piles. He had so many of them. And the string of houses along Franklin Street on the east side was supposedly built in all one summer. He built, I think, all of the early churches. I'm not sure about the St. Athanasius Church. But strangely enough, you look at the picture of looking up Franklin Street in 1906, and you look up there now, and it looks the same. The trees are different and so forth, but you can see a sameness there.
Sure can.
One of the problems of the early times was health care, medical association, medical care and so forth. The old Indian remedies, the doctors came here early, some of them stayed a few years, and some of them stayed their lifetimes. Probably one of the first ones to stay there the longest was Dr. Roberts. I'm sorry, not Dr. Got to stall here for a minute or two. Yeah, here we are. Yeah. Dr. Thomas Roberts, born in Hanover in 1805, came here about 1841. There'd been other doctors previously, but he lived on the corner next to the post offices, and next to the blacksmith, where they all lived. They all clustered together in those days, in the early years. And he graduated from the May Medical School in 1830. He practiced a little while in Norway, and he came here, and he raised his family here, and he died here in 1876. And interestingly enough and tragically, his whole family died before he did. They all died of consumption. The days of getting around by the doctors were Well, they were pretty tough. They rode some of them on horseback, and some of them with the horses and wagon, and some by pung and sleigh. Here's a doctor taken off from his office just before the turn of the century in the wintertime. Most doctors had three horses and sometimes four because they were on the road all the time, and they would make a call and come get a fresh horse and go in another direction, make another call, and they go in night and day. Some of the early doctors in Rumford Falls kept their horses in stables at the end of the park, Strathglass Park. The Indian cures and remedies were being advertised at that time, and you can see from the pictures, Indian Kickapoo Saguar was an old cure-all for everything. Another one here was they all came around with these. You could buy these in the stores. It was the gargling oil. But doctors had it tough. We mentioned that they relied upon their horses. Their recreation was racing those horses, and that's how a lot of horse racing got into a style in this country. In the summertime, people didn't have the colds and the flu so much. The doctors had a little more time. They could take a Sunday off, and they'd take their best horse out and race them against the other doctors' best horse. In fact, they had a race track at Rumford Corner. The lady had became a gravel pit. Two of the early doctors that were here at the time the mills came in was Dr. Stuart and Dr. Abbott, Dr. Hiram Abbott and Dr. James Stuart. They were known as Dr. Jim and Dr. Hiram. They never called them Dr. Abbott. And they were taxed tremendously when the population became increasing, because from 1887 to 1883, they were the only doctors in town. Dr. Small came to Rumford Center and then went on to Portland. But by 1900, there'd been a campaign on to get doctors here because Stuart and Abbott just couldn't handle it. By that time, they were joined by Dr. Ryan, who incidentally left to go to Millinocket, a Dr. Houghton, Dr. Bisbee, a Dr. Wheat, and Dr. Albert Stanwood. And then, of course, to name them all in the years since 1900 would take a list of a mile long. The first hospital was the McCarty Hospital, established in 1907. Dr. McCarty had come here and shown in this photograph out the fellow in the white coat on the right. This was a picture taken sometime between 1902 and 1907 of the Oxford County Medical Association South Paris, either South Paris or Norway. Dr. Bisbee is pictured just at the left of Dr. McCarty, and Dr. Stuart is on the left here with a plaid necktie. Now, then the hospitals came in. In 1907, it was a 2-bed hospital in the park. And then it was changed to a 12-bed hospital in the park. And then Dr. McCarty formed his hospital on Main Avenue, which continued on for years. And then, of course, the operation and the opening of the Rumford Community Hospital, which opened in 1926, and incidentally, that was probably one of the last acts of Waldo Pettengill to participate in a thing. He was a dedication, right. And as we get down more into modern history, we go over the years with wood driving, wood harvesting. The first drive on the Androscoggin took place in 1802, when a man come up here from the name of Toppin, come up here and contracted with two landowners to put lumber on the river. Well, lumber was a waste product. He would give them $1,000 for all the lumber that they put in the river and landed in Brunswick. If it didn't get to Brunswick, they got nothing for it. And they had marks. They had to mark the timbers with a certain thing, same as they did with stamps afterwards. And so that went on. That was the first drive. Probably no river drivers at all. I have one here of these. Here was a log jam at the foot of the falls when they were floating it down over, and they had to, at that particular jam, the story goes that three men lost their lives in that one, breaking that jam. And then they started breaking them up by dynamite. And there's one about in the same area being broken up by dynamite. Lumbering was a big thing in those days. It was up in the Rangeley region. There is a scene, an early one, when long logs were hauled out of the woods by trains. They put the trains back in the woods.
Now that was known as what? Lombard?
Right? No, they run the tracks up in there. Probably on one branch of the Swift River. Later on, they started hauling wood into the mills with horses and huge loads. And there was a load. I can't tell you where that load is. But the river driving was... Here is a scene of the men loading it under the river just after the ice goes out. And a lot of that wood and long wood was landed on the east branch of the canal.
Right, where everyone has seen 4 foot.
That's right, That's right, that was where the long logs were. And here is seen near Rumford Point in a log jam. They didn't necessarily jam over the falls. They could jam most anywhere. We come down now to probably the some of the tragic things that happened, and one of them was the disaster of the sinking of the Dawn when that July day, 1941, yeah, July 3rd, the Dawn just sank with all those people from Rumford. It was a truly sad day. There were 28 local residents went down on that ship. And here is an account of the how it was written up in the Times, probably the boldest print was ever printed in the Rumford Falls Times. Those people, there was hardly a person in town but what was touched by that tragedy. Either it was a relative, a friend, an acquaintance. They had the the shock on the town was
never seen like in that dimension before.
They were all on this.
Well, it was organized by, I truthfully don't know how it was organized, but presumed to be organized by the people that worked in the Rumford Falls Trust Company at that time.
In the banking industry.
But there were, anybody could go, and anybody in town, if you'd been invited, you certainly would have gone, because it was the best people in town. Was the doctors on there? It was a miracle. They say that Paul Thurston, the president of the bank, wasn't on there, because something had come up, he'd planned to go. Mm-hmm. But there are other thoughts, said it might not have happened if Paul Thurston had been there, because he might have seen the danger in the type of boat that they were going to go out on. So, but were doctors, housewives, merchants, musicians, fathers and sons, it touched the entire town. And a few days after, when the memorial services were held in Chisholm Park, which is down under the bridge there, it's gone now, people came for miles, and no estimate had been given to the crowds that came there to participate in that memorial service. Newspapers were playing part of the Times. I guess I mentioned before, The owner of the Eastern Maine Argus, the leading paper in Maine, was born in Rumford. We have an artist sketch of the house that he was born in, which was destroyed by fire in around 1895, and another one built on the premises, but in much, much smaller scale. And that house apparently was the only one out in town that had a widow's walk. And here's a picture of his family in Portland. Of course, the first newspaper probably came into town was the Jeffersonian, a paper printed in South Paris, and by Horatio King, and Hannibal Hamlin, who became Vice President of the United States, made on water-struck paper and very low circulation. But the newspaper that got in here mostly was out of Norway and Paris, the Oxford County Advertiser, the Oxford County Democrat, and a whole series of them printed down there. The first local newspaper was dubbed the Canton Telephone, and that was printed down in Canton, later came into Dixfield as a Dixfield Citizen, and then about 1893 came here as the Rumford Falls Times, changed over. And the early editors and owners, one of them, the earliest one, was Edgar Carver, who later sold out to Tracy Barker. And Tracy Barker was one of the colorful editors of the Times over the years. He came here in 1908 and was here 12 years and stayed and sold out to the Rumford Publishing Company, which became the real owner was James B. O'Kane, and everybody, I guess, remembers that. There were a lot of problems in the early days when Carver owned the paper, but they just straightened out. And, of course, Everett Martin, who was editor there, and a tremendous... in fact, they always said that... Everett Martin was the Times, anyway. When you talk of the Times, you thought of Everett. Honest reporter, thorough, fair, and just. But he was a paper boy when Tracy Barker was there. And he told Tracy Barker apparently was not married. And he was sort of an oddball. And Tracy Barker's afternoon entertainment, Saturday afternoons, he'd buy a bag of popcorn and a bag of peanuts and go up to balcony of the Cheney Opera House and watch the movies all the afternoon with the kids. That was Tracy Barker's style. He went from here when he sold out. He went to Portland and worked a number of years for the Portland Press Herald. We're getting down into the later years when the Depression hit, and that was a really tough time. So in fact, it was so tough that you can't get many photographs of the time because nobody had money enough to buy films. But one of the good things that did come out of the Depression was the Civilian Conservation Corps camps. And a lot of Rumford people, young men, participated in that program. They were paid, I believe, $30 a month for their work. $25 of it was sent to their parents, and they could keep the $5 for themselves. And about here is a photograph of the camp at Rangeley, the Civilian Camp Conservation Corps.
So this was a federal finance?
The federally financed program. But when we got into the depth of the Depression, in around 1931, 1932, the mills were working 2 to 3, maybe up to 4 days a week. People were fortunate in this respect that they did keep the mills going. They cut the hours down, while some places they shut the mills down for a period of time and then opened them up again. But here, they cut the hours down so the people, the employees, did have some income coming in. The world caused layoffs. The town itself suffered business, and I think the year 1932, the records show that welfare costs in town, the total welfare costs exceeded the cost of maintaining roads and plowing the snow and maintaining that phase of town government. The town had trouble borrowing money. Sometimes I think in 1931 to 32, they had to have a series of something like 8 or 10 town meetings in which they would vote to borrow money, and the banks wouldn't let them have it because it was something wrong in the vote. Consequently, the town employees could not be paid. There were two winters that the snow breaking crew, road crew, didn't work all the time. They only worked when it was a snowstorm. If they got a snowstorm and they got the roads cleared out and didn't snow for a week, they didn't work again for a week. There was one time that the school teachers went 12 weeks without pay. There were 2 years that they pay was cut. And there was 1 year in 32 when 12 teaching positions were eliminated. That's the story. You see, there was no such thing as Social Security, unemployment compensation, any of the alphabets then. If you didn't, the last resort was pauperism, they called it in those days. So the Depression had a tremendous effect, but then the federal projects come in. The what's called Emergency Relief Administration, ERA, which Oliver Pettengill headed up. He had been town manager, but he chose to, and was appointed and chose to take the job. And that's when the Houghton Road went through to a Quassic, and the damages from the floods were repaired. And by 1936 and 37, things were coming out of it. People were feeling better. They had more income. But the one historian's theory is that the Depression brought people together. They'd gone through the roaring 20s, the gay 90s, and the roaring 20s, and things would get a little bit wild. And but during the Depression, well, they shared a loaf of bread with your neighbor. You know, if your neighbor was sick, and some other neighbor would go in and spell them and sitting up with them at night, that sort of thing. It was a lot of sharing going on, and it brought them together. And of course, by the time the outbreak of World War II, things had pretty much settled back. It was the town, the whole country had gone through a difficult period. We didn't have too much on police. We know there was police and fire because around 1890, when the corporation was formed as a result of the people in the industrialized part of the town, the populated part of the town, wanted services that the outsiders couldn't afford. They formed this corporation, and that included police, fire, street lights, and sewers, and some other services, garbage collection, I guess, another one of them. So to trace down, we know there was a police department, and the police department, by 1912, was located on Waldo Street. And you can see by the pictures of there were five men there, the pictures of them show you that they wore pretty heavy clothing. They weren't sitting around inside too much. In this picture here, luckily we have the names in the front row on the left of John Violet. In the middle was Frank Brooks. On the left was Frank Brooks. In the back row on the left, a man by the name of Gendron. Chief Gilpatrick was in the center, and Ollie Murray was on the right. Now they're rugged looking gentlemen. I don't think you would want to tangle with them.
We were on Waldo Street.
I can't tell you. I never have found out, but there was an indication of a police station on Waldo Street. Mm-hmm. The fire station was next to the wigwam on Canal Street.
Okay.
In the later years, I can't tell you, but this was probably in the late 20s, the police department became more modernized, and by then they had a motorcycle cop. No automobile, but a motorcycle. Oh. And of course, Jack Dennis was the boss man then. And now, as we get into the final phase here, there was, to show you the terrific changes in what has happened here over the years, and then some places haven't changed so much as you might think. Here is the change here of the original Kimball Martin farm, where the Wild Animal Park is. Is drawn by a tinted photograph, established in 1800, and there's taken the picture from the same position that the earlier one was taken. So you see, there was a tremendous change. Here we have a scene in Rumford Point. Then, around 1900, and as it appears today in the same location in Rumford Point, looking in the other direction, up through. So it was the old Kimball farm, and the elm trees standing out there, shading the eyes. The elm trees are gone, the road just widens, and it's different. Where the Eagles place, the Eagles Hotel, what do you want to call it, stands today, stood the Cloverleaf Hotel. And there it's. That's right. And there's another photo that will show that.
Right.
Now, near Rumford Corner, what is now Rumford Corner, called Rumford then, where there's a gravel pit now was the racetrack. And there is the judges' stand on the racetrack. And that's where the doctors raced their horses, and anyone else that had a horse wanted to race against them. Too bad the gravel has been taken out and the brush has come in. Some of the early houses have been restored, and it's a wonderful thing, and a wonderful thing to happen. Here we have the was known as the Phineas Wood Place, later followed by the Hoyts and the Barkers, showing the structure with a hip roof. It had been restored, and it shows then and now. Those old buildings had the framework that never budged. Post and beam.
Building just as straight as it
was. Just straight as it ever was.
Beautiful job of restoration.
Here's another one of the same type, only this had the pitch roof, probably built by a different builder, of what was first known as the Hezekiah Hutchins farm, then David Elliott there, then the Howard family. Preston Howard and generations lived there, now Dr. Martin's place, but here you can see the resemblance, probably close to 100 years difference there. But you note the ridgepole of the house, there's no sag in it. It's one of those houses that stood up over the years, and there are many more over the country that have been restored. Now here's another hip roof, and there were, incidentally, a lot of hip roof places. I found pictures of them in Dixfield, quite common, and probably the same builder built them all, but this was known as the Moody Place. I don't have a now picture of it, but the now would look almost identical with it today. It's been kept up over the years, I think about 3 or 4 generations of the Moody family lived there. It's just down below Rumford Corner. Chief of Police of Mexico lives there now.
Right.
Here is one taken of the first year of the municipal building having been built in 1916. And that is the way it looks today. And we show this because here was a tremendous piece of history that took place in this building, a modern history. In the meeting house at Rumford Center, the town meetings were held until, I think it was 1892 or 3. Then they went to the wigwam, which we've seen and talked about. And then 1916, until the modern high school was built, events were taking place in this building. In fact, I graduated. My class from the, in the municipal building. All of the policemen's ball, the firemen's ball, the ski carnival events. And incidentally, they were extended over the years. The ski carnival, the Chisholm Ski Club was organized right back in the 20s. And all of their events were held there. Redpath Chautauqua was held there. And one of the notables that came here to speak, President Taft was here at one time. He was ex-president at the time, but it was a big, big affair.
And he spoke in the municipal building.
He spoke in the municipal building. And here is a sign thing showing then and now.
Post office being added, when did
the fire station. Post office was built the following year. I think it was, following year. And then the fire station on the right was built in the early 20s.
Right.
As we wind this down, you have many thoughts. And one of them is the words of Professor Mariner of Colby College, who wrote, "If a population needs to know where it's going, it better find out from whence it came." Another wrote, you're going to repeat the mistakes of the past if you don't pay attention to history. The interesting thing in recapitulation is, unquestionably, Rumford had a parent. We're a descendant of what is now Concord, New Hampshire. They always said Rumford like Concord, mother like daughter, father like that son. The Merrimack River dissects Concord as the Androscoggin does Rumford. The Conococook comes into the Androscoggin, comes into the Merrimack at almost precisely the same position as the Ellis does in Rumford. The fields, the lands, the only difference is there was a falls in the Merrimack River at Concord of only 25 feet, where in Rumford it's higher. So we finish this, in part at least, and I hope that some people will get some insight as to what went on here in the early days of the Rumford.
Well, we certainly thank you, Stuart, for taking the time. It has been enlightening to me of the many aspects of the history of Rumford. Through all the facets you've taken us, it will certainly live on as part of the legacy that you'll be leaving in Rumford.
Good.
Thank you, sir.